Hello there, welcome to episode 28 of my advanced tutorial series for Dwarf Fortress, and this is going to be the one where we're going to go for Adamantine. So I did my preparations just as I had promised. We cleared out this level and that level completely. This level here, I had a little bit of a run-in with a demon, but as you see here, it's perfectly contained. This level here is the one that we're going to clear during this episode, because when you take a look down here, raw adamantine. That's just what we were looking for. So, to grab that stuff, I have already ordered pits above these lava thingies. And as you see here, water is being dropped down here. So it doesn't really have that much of a big difference between what we are already used to. All right. So today we're going to clear that level. I'm going to give a few extra things that are important, nice to know and such things. So, for example, I'm going to talk about that weird looking construction here and show you why it's cool and how to utilize it, and most importantly, how to process adamantine. So this is also going to be most likely the last episode for this series, because I really don't know what other topics to cover anymore. Do you know any? Then let me know so we can do that. Alright, so for now we don't do much except for quenching those fires. I have already put up a lot of intel here, and what I did see is that we have a solid body here, as you might already notice too. So that's where we will get our base of operations down. So I'm going to go for this one. Yeah, that's looking good. So we're going to remove the flooring here. I also have put up a stash here for rock salt blocks and for doors in general, because we can use them. Well, as you see there, the stockpiles haven't been used yet so far, but well, we get in there. It's all a work in progress. So these things being removed and all, we're going to take a dig down. I already know that this is all quite safe, and all the squares where I have removed this stuff here are safe to pick, so we're going to carve through here. And you see here already those blue things? Welcome to the world of raw adamantine. So we're going to set up shop up here, because, you know, why not? First off, we're going to set up a stockpile for the raw adamantine. You find that just where you find all the other stone, down here. There we go. So this is the stockpile that we require. Adamantine is being processed differently than other materials, so we're going to bring up craftsmen's workshops next. Because adamantine cannot be smelted directly, we need crafts dwarves first. So the crafts dwarves make adamantine transform raw adamantine into what's it called? I think adamantine strands was the name. Anywho, it looks like as if they were turning it into thread. As a matter of fact, that's pretty much what they do. Oh, donkey has been found and already removed. New forgotten beasts showing up, but since we have locked off the caverns completely, I don't fret about that. Alright, so here we have now cleared out that area, and basically we can now continue wherever we see that there's no hollow opening or magma behind. Basically, wherever there's a hollow, be wary. Be very, very. So, here. Almost did the wrong thing. It's a little bit like playing Minesweeper, but only with more deadly consequences if you mess it up. So, as you see here, all those pockets here, they pose quite a threat. You never know what's inside there. It might be a harmless fireball, relatively harmless if you diffuse them properly. It might be an ancient treasure, which is pretty cool when that happens. But it also might be a demon or a angelic being, let's call them like that. Basically, the creatures you can find there can also be like divine servants of certain gods, whatever. So, since we don't want to be locked in with something like that, I'm going to use the following strategy. So, let's see. Yeah, this is a nice corner here. So, I want to know what's inside this pocket. So, what I'm going to do is what I'm always going to do. I'm going to put up what's it called again? Sorry. Fortification, that's the word. But since I don't want to be harassed by whatever's inside there, if there is something inside there which can harass me, we're going to carve it out like that. There's going to be walls left and right to that construction, and in the center is a door. So what's that in short? If there is any demon inside there, we can just block the door forevermore, and that thing, well, it's a little bit clunky and it's a little bit unwieldy, but at least there is no more lethal threat posing by this thing. You can use this strategy on whatever end. The most important part is this is a strategy that you can utilize on spots where you cannot look from above. Sometimes, you know, sometimes the mountain is not willing to share its secrets with you by using the glass scrying technique. So sometimes you just have to dig through. And this wall door thing, I don't even know how to call it, it's a pretty cool way of getting your way forward. It is, on the other hand, though, quite annoying because there's, you know, it's time intense. But, you know, what's time if you can't save yourself from unleashing a deadly demon into your premises? So let's go down here to see. It'll take a moment until this is all set up. It's important to suspend the construction here, because otherwise we will we might get ourselves silly dwarfed. And we're going to do something fun here. Yeah, I just see that this spot here, this door can go for. Oh, well, I can't. I'm sorry. Never mind. Never mind me. I was talking nonsense. Sometimes it's more complicated. Sometimes it's less complicated. It's only one thing for sure, never really the same. So at this point, I feel like it's a good idea to open up the first wet pockets here. So we can get ourselves some more room to move. There we go. Also, don't mind the angry dwarves. What happened there, because of context, was I forgot to make my planters do only planting. What has happened is that my planters were doing pretty much everything except for planting. So, whenever that happens, when your fortress is in later stages of the game, make sure that your legendary planters are really doing nothing else. So in short, all the anger is because they're all wearing flimsy clothes that are almost broken. Because my pigtail production wasn't fast enough, in short. Okay, but most importantly, we got ourselves some raw adamantine. So that stuff is now going to be processed by extracting metal strands. We're then going to put up another thingy here. And I think it was, yeah, you know, you find, of course, the processed adamantine in the cloth area. Who would think anything else? It's metal thread. So, just so you know, one of the many, many various confusing realities of Dwarf Fortress, but you get used to it the longer you play the game. Alright, so you see we did a little bit of a floody thing here, but that's no problem because we actually know that we're going to be safe. The scrying method, as I like to call it by now, is pretty powerful because it allows you to know where you can punch, although situations like these make you blind. So I'm merely waiting here for the door finally to be installed, so we can finally carve in here. But I think the basic principle should be clear. You can apply this to any corner you like. Basically, we could also scout here by just slapping walls here and here and then a door here. We can check out what's going inside there. Where you position it and how you do it, it's up to you. But it has been, for me, one of the most foolproof ways to move myself forward in this dangerous environment. You might ask yourself, Icon, why are you doing this to yourself? Monsters cannot go through fortifications. No, they don't. But some of them, they can't spit webs, and that's where things get really ugly. You know, web spitters, they do that whenever they see somebody. Here it was just a godly treasure. Lucky us, just a nice and dandy buckler. But if there would have been a web spitter in there, and I wouldn't have been secured like that, whenever somebody would be going close to that thing, this monster turns into a Gatling gun of web spitting then. And in short, your workers will get there and drop their work, get there and drop the work, because they will be constantly attacked, constantly in panic, and all these things, and it's just a nightmare. This little construction here, yes, it's a tad bit tedious to do it beforehand, but it saves you so much stress when it comes down to these things. By the way, items like this Regoslan, if you want to equip them, you just need to go into the equipment schedule thing here, details, and then you can define what kind of shield you want to do. Go for a material, and then you need to check out those weird metals. It's a little bit uncomfy. You need to check out what kind of metal that item is, and then you can select it. Keep in mind that many of these godly treasures that you find down there are also not necessarily made for dwarves. I still struggle with finding a good use for these items. Dear comment section, enlighten me with your dwarven knowledge, because I personally haven't found much use except for putting these things on a pedestal. Most of them I wasn't even able to smelt down. So, let me know if you know more than me. So, here we can now continue with this procedure, but I think most of these things have become clear by now. So, very, very important public service announcement when it comes down to Adamantine. First time you hit Adamantine, it's basically most of the time A-okay. But when you dig deeper and you go for the scrying method as you should, whenever you find a pocket that's larger than this, specifically 2-on-2, keep it covered. This is the entrance to what people like to call the circus. Officially, it's not a circus at all, it's the underworld, that's where all the demons come from. And once you punched a hole into that, you are, yeah, you're in for the fun. They're going to pour into this world and they're going to attack the hell out of your fortress until there is no man standing anymore. So demons behave just like all the other forgotten beasts. They just fight until there's nobody to kill anymore. So that means if you ever accidentally might, or if you're afraid that you accidentally might open a gate to that area, you should know two things. First off, just like all the other forgotten beasts, that means they're also susceptible to the same strategies, like doors, bridges, and the like. You can easily get yourself ahead of this problem by securing the area. Like, for example, you could set up a safe house around the staircase, or the door, or a bridge, or anything. If you ever have the feeling you might be not aware of that situation once it happens, you can easily create, how to call it, little seals that you can lock off if ever anything goes wrong. What's worth noting, though, what's really, really important to know, every adamantine vein, every one of them, every single one of them, will ultimately have an entrance into the underworld. You will be not safe from that menace. You will be never, ever finding one, as far as I know. Correct me if I stand wrong here. This is basically the implemented risk of the whole thing. It's the whole digging too deep meme that we know since Tolkien, and you know, that because of that, it's really, really important that you get yourself prepared for that. Ironically enough, it is dirty cheap to prepare yourself, because with that method that we're applying here, there will be no bad surprises in any way, you know what you're getting yourself into. If you ever have not the option to put glass flooring on top of that, well, you just see what we're doing here. This method is also nearly as foolproof, because if ever you open up something that you can't handle, just seal that door and let it closed forevermore. Put walls around it so no ghost or gremlin or whatever entity can punch it open and you're good to go. So in that regard, with the as long as you take enough time, it's ridiculously easy to get yourself through that. But the risk is always involved in being hasty and rushing things. That's when things get interesting, and that's where the risk factor kicks in. I'll leave that up to you how you want to ride your rodeo. I personally like to work myself forward here, ever so slowly and ever so safely, and digging out that adamantine in relative safety. But you can, of course, skim through here faster and go for meme runs. Whatever you want to do, it's up to you. It's your sandbox. So, I think we have seen down here what there has to be seen. Of course, the underworld entrance is not visible at this point. Like I said, two on two. It's hard to miss. Once you find what I'm talking about, you'll probably notice it. Now, the stuff that we've processed in these adamantine strands is what we're now going to get towards the magma workshop. I think it was F5, was it? Yeah, here. So we're going to put up a new work order here at the smelters. Adamantine strands can be transformed into adamantine wafers. This is identical to adamantine bars, basically, with one caveat. They are literally smaller than the regular bar. That means you need more wafers than you would need bars for every project. So I think it was 9 wafers for one statue versus 4 bars for one statue. But don't take my numbers too seriously here. But we get to the point that the numbers are working against you in that regard. The game wants you to dig deeper and ever more greedy. And as you see here, this is all full of adamantine. So one of these veins can yield you quite a substantial amount of that stuff. And as you see here with these methods, it is fairly easy to get yourself through that. So here's a couple of tips that you can help yourself with. For example, if you have embarked on a biome that comes without native sand, because I see the caravan arriving there, you can import that sand. You can ask for sand from the mountain home. You can also specifically ask for glass. So these materials, well, you can just directly import them. But if you want to ask for glass, keep in mind you gotta ask for glass blocks. Otherwise, you'll just get raw glass and you won't be able to craft anything out of that stuff. That's just, necessary for, if I remember correctly, the jewelry department. They are using that stuff, but you won't be able to make floor blocks out of that. Alrighty, so the procedure here goes like that, and ever on. You can get yourself quite far with that, as I said. And the limit is just the entrance to the underworld. Here's a couple of things about the underworld extra. The underworld is constantly spawning demons that are native to your world. Demons are created for every world specifically, so I cannot tell you what kind of demons will be haunting your world. It's always a new thing for every world when it is generated. But they are literally like serial spawning forgotten beasts. They are 8 times as big as a dwarf, and they pose a threat. Every single blow from them, if it is not blocked or deflected by armor, can be maiming quality. So, in short, you don't want to have these guys in melee range. You don't want to fight these guys. In general, the game's idea, design-wise, is to convince you that it's a darn bad idea to open a portal to the underworld. I wonder why. I can't really understand that. Those devs are a little bit weird, don't you agree? But whatever might be the case, and jokes aside, you cannot really conquer the underworld in the regular way. The monsters will keep spawning. There is no stop from them to in that degree. So you will ever have the threat of demons spawning into your base, as long as the entrance to the underworld is open. If all these things haven't convinced you yet from not opening a portal to the underworld, then I am very, very proud. I have taught you well. You should have some fun down there. It's really one of those endgame goals where you can try yourself how good you can manipulate the mechanics of the game and utilize all those things. There's a lot of little tricks, and I can't only say so much. There has been a player who has not only conquered the underworld, he even managed to plant strawberries down there. It's a little literal story, I'm not making this up, and it is hard, but it is possible. So this is one of those real endgame goals that you could set up for yourself if you ever would want to. I haven't made it myself. I have yet to plant my own personal strawberry in the underworld, and I somehow intend to do that one day, but not for today. Let's get back to the adamantine wafers that we were making, right? So that stuff is now literally the material of war dreams. Where are you, adamantine wafers? Damn. But you can also make out of adamantine not only those wafers, look, they look like bars even. You can also make out of adamantine at your loom, search one, here it is, metal cloth. So you can also make clothing out of adamantine. This stuff is really badass. It's super, super valuable, and it is comfortable, and I don't know how well it protects, but oh boy. Ghost killed a person. He shoved him down the staircase. Sorry, those things are super distracting. So a ghost popped up and shoved a dwarf down the staircase, which killed him. Just dwarf fortress things happening. So we have to bring up a memorial slab, and where was I? Yeah, I was talking about adamantine clothing. Maybe this guy wouldn't have died with adamantine clothing, who knows? But in short, most people don't use adamantine clothing because there's just way too many other tasty usages for that. Namely, armor and weapons. So when you're making armor out of adamantine, you're getting a super powerful stuff, and you're also getting a super lightweight material. So it's the best of two worlds. Also, when you're making weapons, make sure that you're not going to make any hammers or maces out of that. Like I said, adamantine is a lightweight metal. That means it makes really, really sucky hammers. It does, though, have quite a tradition for equipping hammerers with it. You know, the people who fulfill the lethal justice. Because this way somebody can be ordered to receive a death sentence, but if it is fulfilled by an adamantine warhammer, there's a good chance that the person will actually survive it. That's how good they are. So, on the other hand, if you go for slicing weapons though, like swords, axes, and those things, that's where adamantine shines. It's the most powerful material in the game, there's nothing beating that. And it's also the most valuable material in the game, so making statues or furniture or whatever out of it is always a grand idea and makes all the dwarves happy. You should totally make a throne room with that, or whatever pleases you. Just make sure that you do something which inspires you to need too much adamantine. That's my personal tip here. So with that being said, I really don't have that much more to tell you about Dwarf Fortress at this point. I'm pretty sure that there are way more things that you could do and can do, but I hope this tutorial series has given you the ways and means. I mean, by all means, if in the comment section something really good pops up, I will do another episode until I have covered every possible topic, sure. But I don't see anything, you know, once you are behind that stuff, you are knee-deep in the sandbox, and it's up to you now to forge your own story. That's why I try to bring all those bad ideas into your mind, because if you don't, bring up your own story, this game can get quite boring after this point, because most threats in this game can be countered by just time and preparation. So be your own friend and bring up really, really deadly things for your dwarves and make their life miserable. Embark on an evil biome. Whatever you think is a bad idea, try it out and try to survive it. You will really, really enjoy yourself. Or build yourself a mountain home. There's a lot of things. That being said, I thank you so much for watching. Maybe there will be a next episode. Maybe there will be some other Dwarf Fortress project where you will watch my stuff. Either way, I'd be really happy to hear from you. Leave me a thumbs up on that video. Leave me your subscription if you want to support the channel. That's the cheapest way to do. And if you hit that bell thing, you even stay notified with all the new stuff that I'm publishing here. So, have a wonderful day, thanks for watching, and check out the playlist links down below for more Dwarf Fortress related stuff, and most importantly, have a wonderful day and enjoy your games.